on coronavirus, the one of the sectors, agriculture, that has been hit at a large scale. And agriculture is a sector, or agriculture is an industry, where large number of human resources are involved. If you see the employment generation in this sector, you see its contribution to the livelihood, it's huge. Even though it's say only the 14%, but we should not go with the 14% of GDP. You see amount of people involved into it. That is huge. No, India is not, India, we cannot have a picture of India without agriculture. So there are two things. One is that how the coronavirus has been impacted on agriculture, and what are the new opportunities, or what are the existing opportunities which are available in this sector, where our youth or whoever came back from the cities to the villages, what are the opportunities from there? So we will try to see how the entire Indian agriculture economy has been getting shaped because of this COVID virus. Just I say, we will start with what is the Indian agriculture economy. Especially, we will try to focus on export, because the government of India is focusing on agriculture export. See, India is the country where all kind of agroclimatic conditions are available, where you can cultivate anything, any crop of the world which can be cultivated in here. See, before I start, I will go back to you to the history. You know, thousands of years, 1,000 years back, we were the global economic power in the world. What was the logic behind that? What was the base behind that? We were in the world global power because our agriculture was very, very strong. Very strong. No, because at that time, there was nothing called as the industry kind of thing. There was no any other business other than agriculture. But slowly, slowly, we forgot about our agriculture sector. We forgot how to do trade. We forgot how to do business. So, and suddenly, we are in the land in some way. No, now the agriculture is a mess. The country, the most productive or most biggest strength of our country is the agriculture. So now we have to see the agriculture in different perspective. See, as I said, India is the global leader in so many agriculture products. You take the wheat, you take the rice, you take the any commodity, horticulture, you have your cereals. That India is one of the leading producers. But if you see in terms of its trade in international market, it's just only 2.5%. So it's a very negligible, and it is not at all ideal for the country like India, which is agriculture dominated. So suddenly, when the Modi government took charge in 2014, they have come up with a new scheme called Doubling Farmers' Income and Doubling Agriculture. What they want to do, they have understood that if India wants to grow, if India wants to do well in the economy, or if India wants to become a global economic power, there must be a huge contribution from agriculture sector. There must be a contribution from each and every component of agriculture. That's why they want, they want the farmers into the main stream of trade and commerce. So that's why they want to double the farmers' income and double the agriculture income. For that context, to do this, at 2018, they have come up with a new agriculture export policy. 17 years, first 17 years out of independent history, we have come up with the first kind of agriculture export policy. It is the first kind of policy which is totally devoted in agriculture. And it has now in that policy, right from sale to marketing, everything has been defined. What should we do? What should not we do? Now it's like reorienting entire supply chain. So like that, agriculture. Seen how the agriculture, what are the exports, what are the categories that agriculture we can do in the agriculture. First category in the agriculture, agriculture sales, we have a very good amount of very good kind of agriculture conditions that produce available which can be exported. The floriculture and seeds, then fruits and vegetables. Fruit, India is the world's basket for fruits and vegetables. The processed fruits and vegetables, then other processed foods, then livestock, then cereals. These are the major category where India can export it. India is exporting. These are the major products. As I say, the major, like the basmati rice, processed foods, petroleum meat, non-basmati rice, fresh fruits and vegetables, poultry and egg. These are the some items where we should consider India is doing well in this sector. See, agriculture export is like a gold mine. As of now, we have not exploited this. And unless we're doing good in agriculture export, our agriculture economy won't flourish. And if our agriculture economy won't flourish, there is no. See, your 70% population of your country is directly dependent on agriculture. So agriculture has to perform well. There is no other alternative for it. So if you see the where we actually major export destinations, like now if you take up Vietnam, what we send to Vietnam, we send the buffalo meat, animal casing, groundnuts, maize, fresh onions. In terms of Iran, see, these are the countries, one side these are countries, and these are the one side which product we are exporting. So why what this slide is showing? It's showing amount of diversity we are having, amount of presence our country is having in terms of agriculture export in the other countries. Then, see, as I said, the government of India is very clear and they're very serious about the agriculture export. So they have come up with so many things. But now, right now, we're trying to consider only on international trade because I would like to push that what are the opportunities available, especially for youth in this sector. So if you come to the export, then see, agriculture is predominantly dominated by farmers. Farmers may not be educated. They are related. They are remote to various places. So in order to do export, in order to be international, the government has come up with so many export promotion policies. Category product-wise, they have various export promotion policies. And for that also, they have various schemes. What are the measures that they are helpful for the exporting, like the export infrastructure development, quality development, market development. Three things are important to do in export. They have various export infrastructure, where under that setting up of post-harvestive harvest handling facilities, financial assistance for setting up infrastructure. See, if you want to put up any plan, you have government is supporting you almost 40% whatever your project cost. You have to have the quality development. These are some schemes which is available, especially for the export. And as I said, the government of India has come up with the various export promotion councils. No cashews, like cashew export promotion cost, which is this is only for the cashew spices, like spices inside ginger, turmeric. The spices board is linked to the spices, tea board. You see, tea is one of the India is one of the biggest producer in the tea. We largely export tea, so we have separate board for tea. Then APEDA, APEDA is agriculture export, agriculture processed and export development authority. Under that, India almost 50% export goes from the APEDA, like banana, like wheat kind of thing. Then we have Indian Oil Seed and Produce Export Promotion Council, oil seeds. I tell you one interesting example into it. We know edible oil, 80% of edible oil is imported, 80%. And if you see the production, all kind of production we can do. Like for the edible oil, you need a groundnut, you need a soya, you need sunflower. This all kind of production we easily do in India, but beyond that, we are importing 80% of edible oil. So you can imagine if you are importing 80%, it means that 80% we can produce in India. So you can imagine amount of opportunities is available into this sector. Where is coming from the cities to the villages as a human resource, it can easily be adopted into this sector. If you go with the professionally, see, just traditional approach of production of agriculture, we were thinking agriculture is restricted only to production, but it is not the case. Every crop of the agriculture has a potential industry, as explained with this oil seed. So agriculture has a potential to accommodate so many whoever is coming from the cities to the villages, only we have to go with the traditional approach. So then I have tobacco board, there are so many. I'm just giving some list here, but other than that, there are so many export promotion counselors there who are, their work is only to promote the export. Then I said, if you want to export, what are the things government is supporting or you need? You need a cold storage, you need a collection center, you need a capacity building activities, you need a food testing, you should have pack houses, you should have center for perishable cargo. you should have a vapor heat treatment, you should have irradiation plants, processing plants. So these are the basic infrastructure you need. And this every activity, government is helping. For example, if you want to put up a cold storage, what are the subsidies available here? If you want to go to the coal collection center, if you want to go to pack houses, whatever you need, government is available to help you. Only thing is that you have to take the utilization, you have to take the benefits of this all schemes. Then, along with our sector, one of the major sectors coming is the organic export. So India has a huge potential. If you go to the hilly region of Indian states like Northeast and even the entire Western, all of that farming is a natural farming. So if you go to the villages, into that, even if you take the example of Kolhapur, and if you go to the Azra Chandra, most or maximum farming is on the agriculture with the natural way. They don't give any pesticide, nothing. See, I will give you an example. There are 8 biodiversity hubs in the entire world. By 8 biodiversity hubs, out of 8 biodiversity hubs, there are 2 in India. One is in Western Ghat and second is Himalaya. So whatever things are available in this Western Ghat, Western Ghat is having the 1,400 chloride per gram. So it means whatever produced into that region, it has a very separate kind of taste. And it can have a very premium price. And in this forest and this village, we know our agriculture is just on natural way. Very less amount of organic, very less amount of pesticide or any kind of uses, artificial intervention. So this is the sector. It means Indian agriculture is almost like organic on that region. So it has a huge market. Huge. You, whatever you know, you are getting more than 2 or 3% extra premium for this sector. So this is the one of the area we have to be explored. Then I would like to say, what are the top 10 export product of India? What are the top 10 produce we are producing or we are exporting? Like mango pulp. For the pulp, Dubai is like an ocean. You can make a pulp of anything. You can make a pulp of mango, you can have a grape pulp, you can have any other pulp. Dubai is like an ocean, but it has a huge market. Then grapes, you know already grape. India is one of the biggest exporting the grapes, especially in the Nashik region, entire region. We are doing very solid kind of grape. Then dry-added onion. See, time has come now. You should not, right now, earlier what we are thinking, India is just, agriculture is just a production. No, but we have to go ahead. What do you mean by go ahead? You have to make the value-added product. For example, if it is onion, you cannot be stand only with the fresh export of onion or only the cultivation. You have to make the value-added product, like you have to make the onion powder. You have to make the dry-added onion. No, various kind of, that has a great demand. So that's why the dry-added onion is coming. Then mango, already we have a great, our mango is going throughout the world. Then pomegranate, then gherkin, then groundnut, then meat. India is the one of the biggest exporter in this meat industry. It may be the buffalo, especially the buffalo meat. Then the basmati rice, both the basmati and non-basmati rice. So these are the just, I'm putting some top 10 commodities. Along with there are various things, like tea is there, like the cashew is there, spice is there, turmeric, so many things. But for this understanding, I'm just putting a 10 product here. And then where our export is going? What are the major destinations? Major destinations of UAE, Kuwait, Iran, Indonesia, USA, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Malaysia, UK, Canada. For sending or for doing export business with the Middle East countries or other than that, development is very easy. But if you go with the American countries and European countries, they have very stringent kind of rules. They put so many requirements. If you case with the this Dubai kind of countries, entire Middle East, the big market for India. Because their culture and our culture is almost the same. And a huge amount of Indians, it's like Indian and South Asian culture. So these countries are the biggest market. So I'm just giving you a glance of where we are actually going. And then I will come slowly, what is the impact on this, on COVID, on this, all the activities and what are the opportunities. Then I show you, these are the existing things. But these are the already established market. These are already big players are available in this market. But those who want to come into this business, where they should concentrate? Which product they should go? So we have identified 20 new products where there is a huge business opportunities available in terms of export. In that, banana is there, potato is there, fresh flour there, dried flour there, vegetable seeds are there, juices are there, jaggery is there. Then for ready-made products are there. This is called IRT. Then cereals are there, pig meats are there, poultry are there, dairy product, moringa is a huge potential. Then millet products are there, makhana is there, potato flakes are there, biscuits, wine, organic products. See, these are the not just 20 product. Each product has a separate industry. Like a banana is not just a cultivation. Banana is a separate independent industry. For example, you can have a cultivation. You can have a separate processing plant like a sugar plant where you can have a various product of banana. Like you can have a banana powder, you can have a banana juice, you can have banana chips, then export. So every industry is a separate, every product has a potential of separate industry. So that's why I'm completely saying whoever is coming from cities, whoever's job has been gone, they can easily come into the agriculture and it can be accommodated. But only thing is that our approach has to be traditional agriculture cannot accommodate everyone. We have to be shift our agriculture from production based to market economy. What do my market economy mean? Market economy means we have to see our agriculture in terms of industry. For example, banana is not only production. We have to see other possibilities that how banana can make an interesting product. Like I told you, making a powder or making a juice kind of thing. So if you go with that approach, everything is available. And for that thing, or because of that only, the government of India has now established a separate scheme called the New Agriculture Export Policy. In that policy, this all the things has been pushing, literally pushing. And if you see the Prime Minister has announced the COVID, the Atmanirbhar Bharat, and that in that entire sector, you might have seen easily that large amount of focus has been given into agriculture. India cannot be Atmanirbhar without Atmanirbhar in agriculture. So these are the top 20 products where new export or new business opportunities available, which can be tapped by everyone. And I'm telling you, this is a huge sector. Whoever wants to enter into there, there is no, there may be competition, but there is a scope available for everyone. And then I said, okay, these are the 20 commodities, but where should we send this product? Where are the buyers available? The buyers, potential countries are Argentina, Australia, Bangladesh, China, France, Germany, Indonesia, Italy, Japan, Kazakhstan, Mexico, Nepal, New Zealand, Oman, Qatar, Russia, Singapore, Sri Lanka, Uzbekistan, Vietnam. These are the countries, potential countries, where we should concentrate. I'm just giving one indicative list. And India has a very strong or very good relation other than China with all the countries. You know, where we have very friendly environment and they like Indian food. I would give you one example of cashew nut. See, world's best cashew produced in India. And though India has so many competition like Vietnam and some African countries, but the first preference is given to Indian cashew. Like that, it is a case with so many products of India, you know, almost all the products. Because why? Because our climatic conditions are very much suitable for agriculture. So whatever produced here, it has a very unique taste. That's why I mentioned two things. One is biodiversity hub of this Western Ghat. Western Ghat means exactly where your college is situated. That entire, you know, right from Kanyakumari, right from Gujarat to Kanyakumari, that entire Pachim Ghat, and same with the Himalaya. So as of now, no, we are not utilizing that still. We are not projecting India into that perspective. The moment we are trying to showcase our case into that perspective, no, whole lots of game will be changed. Then I said that these are the potential products. So then one thing is that how the farmer should go. Individual farmers, suppose the farmers are sitting in the village, he cannot, you know, become an exporter since it is international. A small amount of resources, because if you have to export, you have to follow certain procedure. So it may not be possible for one farmer, but if you adopt a certain kind of model, definitely it is possible. For example, you come as a taluka. No, come as a taluka, you identify what particular taluka. Suppose one particular taluka is having very good amount of production of ginger or banana. Then the taluka as a taluka as a whole, they have to work. There should be a different farmers producing companies into it. And that farmer producer company, farmers has to come as a farmer producer company, and they should start some collection center. No, because every village will have a separate thing. So every village should have one production collection, and then should have a product export cluster. So whatever available good into that district, it has to be, or whatever good available into that village, it has to be separate. Like this. For example, Government of India has come with a new scheme called as a agriculture export cluster. So what they are doing into that, ki whatever good available into that district, promote this as an export. For example, they have identified as a banana export cluster. They think that the banana production here has a world class. So in that case, what they have done, they try to promote Kolhapur district at the international level as a banana export. For that, what they will do, they will have a separate banana cluster office into the district. And what they will do, they will have a separate export cluster CEO. He will have his own entire team. And what they will do, they just try to see how the farmers will participate in the international trade of banana. So what they will do, whatever things are required to do export, the government will help them, that particular district department will help them, not only the promoting of, not only establishing the processing plan, they will also give the financial benefit, financial subsistence. And they will try to see right from seeds to the marketing. Whatever things are required into the particular entire supply chain, government will actively handhold the farmers. So this is one of the model by which the farmers may able to do export. They call the grower export. You have to select from taluka, then you have to open a farmers producer company, then you have to setting up the collection center, then you have to go to the export cluster, then you have to need a pack house, then promotion council, and you can export. And then processing. So there are two, if you want to do an export, then there are two categories. One is fresh product and second is processed product. What is my fresh product? Fresh export. No, you just cultivate, harvest the mango or any other thing, or you send it as it is without doing any processing. It's called a fresh export. And second is called a processing. So processing, then you're converting that fresh production into the value added product, like making powder from onion, creating juice from onion, or creating any kind of thing like making a wine from something. So these are the processing. And I'm tell you, the most potential sector or most potential scope in this entire industry is the processing industry. Huge. If you go to the Western countries, 70-80% of their food are processed foods. They don't know. If you see in their dietary habits, you will see they like processing food. Very less, you know, like rice, chapati, these kind of things are very less in their daily day-to-day. They like go for processing. For example, they will have a gherkin, they will have a baby corn, they will have a mango juice, kind of thing they are like. So it has a huge sector. That's why the Government of India has a separate ministry called a Ministry of Food Processing. Because we are not utilizing this sector as much. That's why these industries and ministries have a huge scope. For example, they are even giving up to you 5 crores of subsidy, 50% of subsidies. Even your project is big, they even help you for everything, for the setting up your processing plant, even setting up your market linkages, kind of thing. And now they are also concentrating with these small self-help group, FPOs. Now the big processing industries will not only belong to the corporates. Now they're thinking that the small farmers, small FPOs, small sole groups has to come into this. So for that also we support it. For that also we have developed a separate model. So if you want to put up a separate processing factory here, then you can do other way. For example, 3-4 taluka come together, farm producer companies, then farmer product export cluster, then collection center, then farmer processing cooperatives, farmer export and export. So these are the two models by which farmers or small groups can be able to do export. So these are the export opportunities. Now I will devote a little bit of time on how this entire COVID reshaped the entire agriculture economy. For that, I will give you one example. Government of India or the farmers or all the experts in this industry, they were demanding some reforms from last 17 years, the reforms in agriculture, because of which we were not able to do great, or our farmers are not operating themselves. What was the reform? From independence, we were demanded that the essential commodity has to be removed. But as of now, no government has not a day to remove that act. Only in that last month when the Prime Minister announced in this Atmanirbhar Bharat, because that was something which was needed in this economy. What was that act? What was this restriction put in that act? That act was put in restriction that whatever you produce, and if that come under the essential commodity means there are 21 commodities where the farmers doesn't have any right. The right is only belong to government. For example, onion is there, rice is there. These are the things. No, you cannot sell. Farmers cannot sell. If the farmers want to sell, it has to go to the mandi or it has to go to the what we call market committee, and it has to sell to certain amount of. Sorry, those who are the registered or those who are the having the monopoly traders. Farmers were not having right to sell it. So the government has put that restriction, remove the restriction, remove that act. Now the farmers can sell their product to anyone at any price. There is no restriction on it. There is no limitation on it. No one can stop farmers. Earlier, the major benefits only go to the trader. Now it is not the case. Now it is that the farmers can have that privilege that he can sell his product to anyone. For example, earlier what is that? But if you want to sell anything, if you want to sell a tomato or if you want to sell a rice, the farmer has to go to the mandi only, market committee only. He has to sell to that registered trader only at his price. Now what will happen since farmers have this restriction has been removed, farmers are able to sell anyone. He can sell to anyone. That was the major reform in the sector. Second reform that earlier there was a restriction that the farmers cannot store, or other than the registered farmer or other than the registered traders cannot go to the farm and sell, or they can have a buy. Now the restriction has been, now the farmers can store anything. Farmers can store any amount of money. Or now that's why the new opportunities come. How the new opportunities come? Whenever there's off season, farmers can store their product. For example, in the onion, if you see in the last October, the price of the onion is almost 200 rupees. We had to import the onion from Kazakhstan, we have to Kabul, because there's a huge number of shortage of onion and the price has been shorter. So in that case, whenever there's harvesting of onion, farmers can store that onion in their storehouses. And they can, whenever there's a good price, whenever there's off season, farmers can come in the market and sell it. Like that, farmers will get the good amount of benefit. And this opportunity is not only the farmers, it is available for everyone. So storage of product has been one of the big sector where the youth of the farmers or youth of the farming community or other people can have the benefit. Third reform was that, suppose there is one factory. And they are in the chips, potato chips making. Earlier, what was happened? That factory has to go mandi only, market committee only, and they have to procure the raw material from there only. They were not allowed to go directly to the farmers. Now, with such kind of food processing factories, directly can have a contract with the farmers. Directly, they can go with the farmers, and directly they can procure the farmers or procure the material from there. So what will happen in that case, that कि फार्मर्स द प्रॉफिट मार्जिन वाज गोइंग बिटवीन द फार्मर्स एंड द प्रोसेसर दैट मिडिल मैन वाज दैट वी रिमूव एंड द रियल बेनिफिट एंड द रियल प्राइस ऑफ एंटायर थिंग विल गो टू द फार्मर्स सो दैट वाज द हैपन इन द फर्स्ट टाइम द हिस्ट्री ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस इंडिया सो लाइक दैट व्हाट विल हैपन न्यू काइंड ऑफ नो ट्रेडिंग मे कम टू द मे विल come to this sector and the government is promoting the what kind of trading government is trying to see him or they are pushing some mechanism that at the time sowing only the farmers will assure what final price of the product at the time sowing only for example can any food processing company have the how the farmers can take the part in this business and I told you that there are two ways of getting export one is that production and second is the processing you can go with the both the ways since far one for the individual farmers is not possible to start any processing plant if he doesn't have that much amount of money and resources then this is the model which can help them to do that so these are the opportunities in the sector just I was telling I will now I will little bit glance on how this COVID is making impact As I was telling that Atmanirbhar Bharat has given a lot of opportunity, a lot of impetus in this sector. Now, see, this sector, entire sector, how it's working, how it's there. See, why these people from villages went to the cities, what was the reason that they were not able to sustain themselves into the agriculture sector? Their livelihood would get disturbed. There was not sufficient amount of money in this sector. But this is not going now the government has understand if they wants bring because of them no this villages also or cities also getting disturbed because a lot of population from villages are going to the cities and they are going there is no point into that so what is the solution into the solution into that you have to make the agriculture sector such viable that there is no need to go to the outside for any job or any kind of thing So for that, the one thing is that government is clearing thing that can we develop a such amount of infrastructure or can we see the agriculture in that context that the new youth or the youth of the or the new generation of the farmer can step back into the villages and this can they start their own enterprises? Can they start their own businesses based on whatever resources available in the villages? That is the question, and I will tell you one example. The suddenly a lot of people are coming from villages, from cities to villages. Now most of them people they don't want to go back to the cities. And now paradza it's nahi hai. Most of them they don't want to go back to the villages, and they are putting pressure on various state governments that you have to. Create something for us here into the villages only that we don't want to go back to the cities then government is asking to us as an expert or as a policy maker they were government various state governments ministers were asking that this is the situation what we can do then they finally they come to conclusion that they have to do something in agriculture world so the agriculture is in prime focus Now every state government trying to reorient their entire agriculture because they have to sustain the entire human resources who came back to their own villages, and if they want to sustain, then how they cannot sustain this entire thing by traditional way of farming? It is agriculture farming, no, just production only farming, just cultivation of onion or any product for that matter. And harvest is not enough. You have to see the further processing. You have to see the further value chain. And if you want to do, then you have to send it to export market. Because something India is something doing. No, it has very strong qualities for the agriculture exports. So government of India is trying to see. That's why they're pushing that our export or our agriculture has to be export oriented. For that matter. The entire supply chain has been rerouted. For the what they need, they have to follow the good agriculture practices. So, entire fund mechanism, our resources come. They have to see the processing practice. So, entire fund mechanism. So, wherever the support is required, government is ready to extend. So that's why I'm again and again emphasizing this is the most vulnerable sector, as well as this is the most, it is the biggest strength of India. This is because of you know, other than this, we cannot go ahead. So that is the real opportunity. The youth of the farmers, next generation of the farmers are educated. No, for example, our generation, our parents were the farmers. They were educated. They are not educated. So they are just concentrating on production. But next generation of farmers who are educated, who has a good experience, they don't want to go away from their own villages. They want to come back and they want to start at something, some kind of business activities on their own farmers, maybe at village level or maybe at taluka level, by putting or aggregating all the resources. So governments would like to tap that team. Government would like to take the benefit of that all and reorient the entire team. So the structural changes are coming into the sector, and government has realized that our governments want another past glory when we were the global economic power, and that at that time the agriculture was the biggest contributor. Governments would like to bring that situation back. So whatever government can do or whatever is possible, is government is ready to extend. So that's why the entire supply chain is reorienting, and whatever inputs are required, everywhere government is supporting. So this is the time now, not only the farmers, other people, entrepreneurs, new entrepreneurs, new processor, new, they have to come into this business, because this is the redeemed time, and this is the redeemed time to do. Next 20 to 30 years, only be the agriculture multinationals, because the people are very much conscious about the food. So the first thing, what was the first thing we feel into this COVID was the food. And food is the long-term business. It's not going to end. It requires every day. So only thing is that we have to see, or we have to follow the certain practices which will make, which will help you to go further. So the time has come from shift the production-based agriculture economy to the market-based agriculture. And I'm giving the message to the entire farming community or the next generation of farming community. So you go throughout the world, you learn, you can come back to your own villages. This is the real sector, local to local. Every product, Indian product, has some unique taste. Every product, I will tell you one small interesting example. When I was doing postdoctoral research, my postdoctoral research was on forest accounting of Polapur district. So what was the forest account? I was doing how the forest is contributing into the social economic development. What is the forest economics? And when I was doing that research, I come across various products into the forest, right from honey, right from ginger, right from bay leaves, so many things. And then I took the one example of honey. I had thought that if it is coming from the Western Ghat, then there must be something unique into this, in whatever the produce into that region must be unique, because we have 1,400 flora and fauna in this sector. Then I took the example of honey. And what I did, I made the entire detailed analysis of the honey, entire laboratory analysis, market, everything. And do you know, you surprise. I collect entire, big brand in the honey, like Monuka honey is coming from Germany, so many honey. I collect the important brand of honey, and I took the honey from that Kolhapur out, that in forest West Bengal region, and I make the comparison. Do you know how the honey's quality is maintained, or how the honey's price is determined? What are the quality parameter? Quality parameter is that how much pollen count is there into the honey per milligram. Jeka milligram honey madhe kiti parakan astat, tyacha varun honey chi quality thate. So what I did, I made the comparison. I first took the Monuka honey. What is the price of Monuka honey? Per kg, 5,000 rupees. Per kg, 5,000 rupees. And how much is the pollen count into that? Pollen count, 2,50,000 per milligram. Highest honey in the world, in terms of cost wise, is Monuka honey, which is having 5,000 rupees kg per kg. And what is the quality? 250,000 colon per count. So like that, they were I making four or five product, and then I took this honey which is coming from the Western Ghats. You know how much is the pollen count available into that per quantity? 750,000 pollen count per milligram. 750,000 pollen त्याच्यामध्ये आहेत, परागकण त्याच्यामध्ये आहेत. So you can imagine if the honey which is having 250,000 pollen count is selling as a 5,000 per kg, then how what should be the value of 750,000 pollen count? I'm just giving one example of it. This is what we have to be. How to be the entire thing. So that's why is a big opportunity in this sector, and fortunately or unfortunately, people or government of India or everyone has realized the importance of farmers and food and agriculture. So this sector is going to be in the center forever, because 70% people of your country is directly available on this sector. So you cannot eliminate them. You cannot go ahead unless you take them with you. Otherwise, it's a mess. So people, government of India, everyone has understand this one. That's why a whole lot of reform is coming, and already whatever there were problem with the due reform was expected, it has been done. So this entire sector has been open for everyone. So this is the right opportunity, and I would like to tell the who are concerned with the agriculture or they want to do something, then this is the potential sector where everything is there ready. Just you have to utilize the thing. So this is the end from my side. If it is in question, I can happy to take. Hello, Jadhav sir.
Hello sir.
Hello.
Sir.
Yes, yes.
Right. From end. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Yeah. Now session is open for discussion. If you have any questions, please ask directly or in typing chat box. काय प्रश्न असतील तर विचारा प्लीज. पार्टिसिपंटना विनंती आहे, काही प्रश्न असतील, काही शंका असतील तर ते विचारू शकतात. देयर इज वन क्वेश्चन इन चॅट बॉक्स सर. पाटील सर,
कॅन यू रीड मी फॉर दॅट? कॅन यू रीड मी?
एज देयर आर एम्पल अपॉर्च्युनिटीज इन एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर, व्हाट अबाउट प्राइसेस?
So prices, that is the same. See, it's all of, at the end, it is a business. Ample opportunities in the sense, I'm telling you that domestic market is not sufficient for us. Domestic, you take domestic market just only as for the consumption. Real business is outside. Real business is in trading. Real business in getting participant in international. For example, you take onion. How much price you will get in onion in international, in Indian market? 10 rupees or 12 rupees. That's it. But if you convert that onion into the powder, and if you sell that powder outside as export, you will get at least 50-60 rupees. So these are the things. You take the any example. That's why I'm saying this is we have to change our approach, right, from production base to the market economy. So we have to do that. Whatever is demanded in the market, we have to see that layer. So whatever is demand in the market, we try to produce that much only. If there is no demand for certain product, then we have to leave that product and see. So that's why I'm saying it is all about business game. Now we have to be, as a farmer, as we have to be sharp. we have to be little bit, we have to come away from that traditional way of practices. We have to see the market also before we go to sowing, and we, I mean, according to that we have to plan ourselves. And plus, no, the time has gone that farmers, no, we just were thinking only about the production base. Now we have to see the all the options available. Now because of the reform is there in this entire sector that we have been eliminated from this Essential Commodities Act, whole thing is ours. So I don't think that the prices is the issue. Issue is that not having right kind of approach or not going with the proper way. If you go with the right kind of approach, as I was explaining the entire motion, that I don't think there is any problem. It's a huge opportunity and the price will be also good. Yeah.
Sir, me Mandre sir bolto. Can I speak in Marathi?
Bolo sir, kasi bolo.
आपली सजेशन खूप छान आहे की शेतकऱ्यांनी शेतमाल विकण्यापेक्षा शेतमालावर प्रक्रिया केलेली उत्पादनं विकावीत. तर यातली एक थोडीशी एक अडचण मला अशी सांगायची सर की शेतमालावर प्रक्रिया करणारे जे भांडवलदार उद्योजक आहेत त्यांचा प्रक्रिया केलेला माल आणि शेतकऱ्यांनी लघु उद्योजकतेच्या माध्यमातून आणि तुटपुंज्या यंत्रणेच्या सहाय्यानं प्रक्रिया केलेला माल याच्यामध्ये पहिली गोष्ट अडचण अशी येते की क्वालिटी मेंटेन करताना त्या शेतकऱ्यांना फारशी जमत नाही. दुसरी गोष्ट याच्यानंतर जे मध्यमवर्गीय व्यापारी आहेत ते जो शेतकरी उत्पादक आहे मॅन्युफॅक्चरर आहे त्याच्याकडून माल घेत असताना ब्रँड त्याच्यापेक्षा ते सुहाना असतील किंवा इतर काही ब्रँडचे माल विकत घेऊन ग्राहकाला विकण्यात जास्त धन्यता मानतात. तर शेतकऱ्याने प्रक्रिया केलेल्या मालाबद्दल मार्केटमध्ये विश्वासार्हता कशी येईल आणि दुसरी गोष्ट भांडवलदार उद्योजकाच्या तोडीस तोड लघु उद्योजकाच्या माध्यमातून क्वालिटी कशी मेंटेन होईल याच्याबद्दल काय सजेशन असेल सांग.
खूप चांगला क्वेश्चन आहे. जेव्हा गव्हर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडियाने 2018 साली ही जी नवीन कृषी निर्यात धोरण आणलं त्यावेळेला आमचा समज असा होता की शेतकऱ्यांचं इन्कम वाढवण्यासाठी तर अॅग्रिकल्चर एक्सपोर्ट वाढवावं लागेल आणि हे ऑटोमॅटिक होईल असं वाटलं. पण नंतर नंतर असं लक्षात यायला लागलं एक्सपोर्ट करणारे जे लोक आहेत ते शेतकरी नाहीच आहेत. एक्सपोर्ट करणारे जे लोक आहेत ते मिडल मॅन किंवा मधले दलाल आहेत. हार्डली 1-2% लोक एक्सपोर्ट करतात शेतकरी म्हणून. आणि शेतकऱ्याला जर खरं पैसे मिळायचं असेल तर एक्सपोर्ट करावं. फॉर एक्झाम्पल तर तुम्ही मँगो समजा मँगो तुम्ही परदेशात पाठवतच नाहीये तर त्याची किंमत ऑटोमॅटिकली देशाच्या बाजारपेठेमध्ये कमी त्याच्यामध्ये सुद्धा कमी होते. जगभर मागणी असल्यामुळे मँगोला ती भारतामध्ये सुद्धा तिची किंमत आपोआप वाढते. तर हे ज्यावेळेस गव्हर्नमेंटच्या लक्षात आलं तर गव्हर्नमेंटनं मग नंतर लक्षात आलं की हे जर करायचं असेल तर फार्मरनी स्वतः करायला पाहिजे. आणि फार्मरनं जर स्वतः करायचं असेल तर एकटा फार्मर हे करू शकत नाही. एकटा फार्मर कारण तुम्हाला ह्या मोठ्या व्यापाऱ्यांशी स्पर्धा करता येत नाही. कारण एकटा फार्मरच ना तो शिकलेला असतो ना त्याला काही नॉलेज असतं. समजा एखाद्याने करायचं जर ठरवलं तरी हे मोठे व्यापारी त्याला ना मार्केटमध्ये यायला देतात. मार्केटमध्ये जरी आलं तर कसा माल पाडून घ्यायचा तर त्याचे रिसोर्सेस फार लिमिटेड असतात. मग गव्हर्नमेंटने काय म्हटलं की हे जर बदलायचं असेल तर त्यांनी म्हटलं की एकत्र यायला पाहिजे फार्मर ग्रुप. मग फार्मर ग्रुप म्हणजे हे FPOs याच्या फार्मर्स प्रोड्युसर कंपनीज आहेत. हा कॉन्सेप्ट आला. आता गव्हर्नमेंट काय म्हणते की तुम्ही एकट्याला शक्य नाही ना. तुम्ही 10 फार्मर एकत्र या, 100 फार्मर आणि 1000 फार्मर एकत्र या. आणि ह्या तुम्ही जेव्हा 1000 फार्मर एकत्र याल आज फार्मर प्रोड्युसर कंपनी तर तुमची जी क्षमता आहे ना ती क्षमता वाढेल. जी क्षमता त्या मधल्या दलालाची किंवा मोठ्या फॅक्टरी तशी तुमची क्षमता होईल. आणि ते करण्यासाठी गव्हर्नमेंट सगळ्या प्रकारची तुम्हाला मदत करत आहे. म्हणजे डायरेक्ट तुम्हाला गव्हर्नमेंटचं सबसिडी डायरेक्ट तुम्हाला लोन पाहिजे असेल तर गव्हर्नमेंट तुम्हाला सबसिडी मध्ये लोन देते. तुम्हाला ग्रँड मध्ये लोन देते. जो फार्मरचा जो प्रॉब्लेम होता की एकट्याला शक्य नाही तो इथं गव्हर्नमेंटने टॅकल इथं तो सॉल्व्ह होतोय. प्लस गव्हर्नमेंट पुढे जाऊन असा विचार केला की हे असं जरी केलं तरी जी फार्मरची जी FPOs आहे किंवा जी त्यांना काही इंटरनॅशनल मार्केटचं ज्ञान नाही त्यांना मग पुढे जाऊन काय करतायत. मग फार्मर्सनी गव्हर्नमेंट दुसरी स्कीम आणली त्याला म्हणतात की अॅग्रिकल्चरल एक्सपोर्ट क्लस्टर. मग गव्हर्नमेंटने काय केलं की हे जे फार्मरने करायचं असेल तर गव्हर्नमेंटला स्वतः फील्डमध्ये यावं लागेल. दिल्लीत पासून या गोष्टी होणार नाहीत, मुंबईत पासून या गोष्टी होणार नाहीत. तर सरकारला स्वतः त्याच्या शेतावरती जावं लागेल. मग गव्हर्नमेंटने काय केलं की भारतामध्ये असे कुठले प्रोडक्ट अवेलेबल आहेत आणि ते कुठल्या कुठल्या जागेवरती आहेत हे आयडेंटिफाय केलं आणि त्यांनी त्यांना सेपरेट क्लस्टर म्हणजे आता कोल्हापूरला त्यांनी बनाना एक्सपोर्ट क्लस्टर म्हणून डिक्लेअर केलं. म्हणजे कोल्हापूर मधले जी केळी आहेत ती इंटरनॅशनल मार्केटमध्ये जाऊ शकतात किंवा जायला पाहिजेत आणि ती केळी मधल्या व्यापाऱ्यांनी न पाठवता शेतकरी कसा ते पाठवेल, शेतकऱ्याला कसा ह्याचा त्यांनी विचार केला. आणि असे त्यांनी भारतातले 2-250 झोन डेव्हलप केले, जसं की त्यांनी सांगलीला बेदाण्यासाठी केला, बेळगावला त्यांनी हे डाळिंबासाठी केला, नाशिकला त्यांनी असं त्यांनी केला. मग ह्याच्यामध्ये ते काय करतात आता की त्या पर्टिक्युलर डिस्ट्रिक्ट मध्ये जिल्ह्यामध्ये एक क्लस्टर सीईओ जसा कलेक्टर आहे तसा त्यांनी क्लस्टर सीईओ त्यांनी सेपरेट नेमला आणि त्याच्या हाताखाली एक पूर्ण ऑफिस दिलं. ह्या लोकांचं काम एवढंच आहे की त्या शेतगाव जिल्ह्यामधले जे सगळे आता बनाना एक्सपोर्ट करायचं असेल तर बनाना लागवडीपासून तो इंटरनॅशनल मार्केटमध्ये पाठवीपर्यंत सगळ्या गोष्टींना मदत करेल. म्हणजे समजा त्या फार्मर्सना एफपीओ कशी करायची, मोठी कंपनी ते तिचं मार्गदर्शन देणे, त्यांना तिथे सपोर्ट करणे, कुठली जात लावायची ते त्यांना सपोर्ट करणे, कुठे विकायचं ते त्यांना सपोर्ट करणे, बाहेरचे जे मोठे मोठे ग्राहक आहेत किंवा जे निर्यातदार आहेत बाहेरच्या देशात त्यांना इथं आणणे आणि यांचं काय हे स्केम चालू झाले. त्यामुळे हा जो प्रॉब्लेम आहे ना की मोठ्या व्यापाऱ्यांचा ब्रँडचा हा प्रॉब्लेम आता हळूहळू सॉल्व्ह होत आहे आणि हा सॉल्व्ह करायचं एक मेकॅनिझम तयार केलेलं आहे. आता प्रश्न एवढा आहे की आपण ह्याचा फायदा घेतो का नाही. आणि शेवटी कसं आहे, हा बिझनेस आहे, थोडेफार रिस्क असणारच आहे सगळ्या गोष्टी काय करून, पण गव्हर्नमेंटने जेवढं शक्य आहे सगळ्या गोष्टी आणल्या ज्याच्याकरून फार्मरला फसवणूक होणार नाही, कुणालाही फसवणूक होणार नाही, फक्त आपल्याला त्या राईट अप्रोचने जावं लागलं. आता ह्याच्यामध्ये मुद्दा असा आहे की जी आता जी फार्मरची जी जुनी पिढी होती, जसे आमचे आई वडील किंवा कुणाचे होते, आता आम्ही फार्मिंग कम्युनिटी आल्यामुळे आपल्याला जास्त कन्सर्न आहे, ते शिकलेले नव्हते, त्यांना काय याचा बेस. आता जी नवीन जी शिकलेली लोक आहेत, जी यांची जी मुलं आहेत शेतकऱ्यांची, त्यांची जबाबदारी आहे कारण त्यांना ह्या गोष्टींचं नॉलेज आहे, ते शिकलेले आहेत, यंग आहेत, त्यांनी या सगळ्या गोष्टींचा फायदा करून गाव म्हणजे समजा एका गाव समजा एक गाव आहे आता समजा एक गाव आहे त्याच्यामध्ये कुठली तरी चांगली समजा बटाटे चांगले पिकतात तर ते गाव ऍज अ गाव म्हणून एखादी फॅक्टरी टाकता येते का आपल्याला. जसे आपल्याला प्रत्येक गावात एक कोऑपरेटिव्ह संस्था आहे या पतसंस्था आहे किंवा डेअरी आहे, तसं काय तशा प्रकारचं मॉडेल उभं राहणं गरजेचं आहे आणि तेच फ्युचर आहे. असं जर आपण गेलो ना तर ह्याच्यातलं सगळा आणि या सेक्टरमध्ये एवढे पैसे आहेत एवढ्या अपॉर्च्युनिटीज आहेत ना, शेतकऱ्याच्या मुलांना किंवा गावातल्या कुणालाही बाहेर जायची गरज नाही आहे. फक्त हे राईट अपॉर्च्युनिटी करायला पाहिजेत. आणि हे जे सगळे जे म्हणजे प्रॉब्लेम होते की शेतकऱ्याला फसवणं किंवा व्यापारी हे आता बऱ्यापैकी इलिमिनेट झालेलं आहेत आणि ह्या सिस्टीमने गेलो तर आपण फसत नाही, त्यामुळे टॅकल होऊ शकतो.
थँक्यू सर, खूप छान सोल्युशन तुम्ही दिलं. मी सुद्धा शेतकरी स्वयंसहाय्यता गटामध्ये गेल्या 7 वर्षापासून काम करत आहे आणि तुम्ही शासनाचे प्रयत्न अगदी नेमकेपणाने नमूद केलेत. मला एक सजेशन वाढवून सर अशी सांगायची आहे, शेतकऱ्याचे जे तालुका शेतकरी शेतकी ऑफिसचे तालुका लेवलचे अधिकारी आहेत त्या अधिकाऱ्यांनी शेतकरी स्वयंसहाय्यता गटामध्ये पुन्हा अजून असे गट केले पाहिजेत की जे क्रॉप्सवर आधारित असतील किंवा सीताफळाचं उत्पादन घेणारा गट, बटाट्याचे उत्पादन घेणारा गट, स्तुती उत्पादन घेणारा गट, शेतकऱ्याचे जे गट आहेत ते सर्व असे ते क्रॉप वाईज वेगळे करून त्याचं क्लस्टर केलं तर बरं होईल. हे एक सोल्युशन खूप छान आहे आणि शेतकरी स्वयंसहाय्यता गटासाठी सरकारचं खूप मोठ्या प्रमाणावरती सहकार्य आहे, ही गोष्ट चांगली आहे. परंतु याच्यामध्ये पुन्हा त्याला उत्पन्नाची समजा दूध डेअरी टाकली, त्या दूध डेअरी मॉडेलवर आधारित जर इतर पद्धतीचे मॉडेल करायचे म्हटले तर पुन्हा उत्पन्नाची अडचण किंवा कमी उत्पादन होणं तेवढ्यासाठी लांबच्या मार्केटला जाणं, मग असं जर 4 तालुक्याचं 5 तालुक्याचं क्रॉप वाईज गट केले शेतकऱ्याचे तर अधिक चांगल्या पद्धतीने याच्यामध्ये विपुलता येईल असं मला वाटतं. थँक्यू.
मी जास्त कन्सर्न का सांगते तुम्हाला कारण सरकारचं जे भारत सरकारचं जे कृषी निर्यात धोरण जे होतं त्याचा मी सल्लागार होतो किंवा अजून पण आहे मी त्याच्यामध्ये. आता लास्ट आठवड्यामध्येच ती मुदत संपली माझी सल्लागार पदाची, पण मी भारत सरकारकडून फार क्लोजली काम करतो या सगळ्या गोष्टींच्या वरती. स्पेशली हे जो कृषीचा जो व्यापार आहे, कृषीचा जो धंदा आहे, ह्याच्यामध्ये मी फार जवळन भारत सरकारकडून किंवा भारत सरकारच्या वेगवेगळ्या संस्थांच्या बरोबर सल्लागार म्हणून काम करतोय. त्यामुळे मला सरळ दिसतं हे का मी सगळं बुक मधून सांगत नाही तुम्हाला. ना माझी अग्रिकल्चरची डिग्री आहे, माझं काही नाही अग्रिकल्चर मध्ये, माझी कॉमर्सची डिग्री आहे, पण मी जवळ ना सरकारमध्ये काम केल्यामुळे किंवा सरकार सोबत काम करत असल्यामुळे मी जवळ बघतोय सगळे. आणि वाईट एवढ्यासाठी वाटतंय की एवढं सगळं असताना सुद्धा आपल्याला याचा फायदा घेता येत नाही आणि ती आपली मिस्टेक आहे. म्हणजे मिस्टेक कुणाची आहे, जे जे शिकले शेतकरी पा बिचारे अड्याने, पण जे नेक्स्ट जनरेशन आहे त्यांना काय प्रॉब्लेम आहे, हे सगळं पुढे दिसत आहे, त्यांनी पुढे यावं, त्यांनी सगळा फायदा करून घ्यावा, त्यांनी सगळे सेक्टर मध्ये आणावं. शेतकऱ्यांची जी मुलं शिकलेले आहे, जे ग्रॅज्युएट आहेत, पोस्ट ग्रॅज्युएट येऊन काही शिकले, पीएचडी पण आहेत, त्या लोकांना जॉब मध्ये तुम्ही 12 तास काम करताय मुंबईमध्ये जाऊन पुण्याला जाऊन तर कोणत्या पगारासाठी, हे सगळं तुमच्याकडे रिअल असेट अवेलेबल आहे गावामध्ये, ती तुम्ही युज करा ना. तुम्ही तुम्ही स्वतःच्या स्वतः यू बी युअर ओन बॉस. आणि हे शक्य आहे. बाहेरचे लोक हे मल्टीनॅशनल कंपनीची लोक, आता मला सांगा लेज कंपनी जी आहे ती काय करते, बटाट्याचे चिप्सच फक्त करते ना शेतकऱ्याकडनं घेऊन, असं आपण व्हायला देणार आहोत का आपलं सगळं. तर हे न होण्यासाठी, हे होण्याच्या अगोदर शेतकऱ्याचे जे मुलं आहेत किंवा जे शिकलेले लोक आहेत त्यांनी एकत्र येऊन याचा फायदा घ्यावा, जेणेकरून ह्याचा सगळा फायदा हा ग्रामीण भागातील लोकांना, ग्रामीण भागातील शेतकऱ्यांना आणि त्यातल्या कम्युनिटीला होईल. नाहीतर आपल्याला, नाहीतर काय बाहेरचे लोक येणार, जमीन विकत घेणार, शेतकऱ्यांनाच कामाला लावणार, शेतकऱ्यांनाच काम करून घेणार, आपली हे न व्हावे ह्याच्यासाठी हा. शेतकऱ्यांच्या आसपासच्या लोकांनीच, ग्रामीण भागातील लोकांनीच धंदा चालू करावा. आणि जेव्हा चालू केल्यानंतर ह्याला जी सगळी मदत लागणार आहे ती सरकारने ऑलरेडी सगळी पोझिशन करून ठेवलेली आहे, त्याचा फक्त फायदा करून घ्यावा.